Welcome back, all of you. Today we are moving on to the second lecture of sixth module, Power System Stability. In the previous class, we have discussed the concept of stability, types of stability, and most importantly, power angle equation PE is equal to Pmax sine delta, where PE represents electrical power generated. Pmax represents the maximum power that is being transferred, which is equal to E1 E2 by X. Where E1 is a sending end voltage, E2 is a receiving end voltage, and X is a reactance of the transmission line connected between the sending end and the receiving end, and delta is the load angle or the displacement of the rotor. Okay. Now, keeping all these under consideration, today we will be discussing the swing equation, which is yet another important topic, and the steady state stability limit. So again, the same reference text is being used, and these are the two topics that we'll be discussing today. Let's move on to the swing equation. Moving on to the swing equation. The swing equation gives a relationship between the swinging of the rotor and its angle. Okay, this is yet another important topic which can be asked even as an essay or as a short answer question. The swing equation. So this is actually the rotor of a machine, and here before starting we need to be familiarized with some terms. That is, T represent torque, Tm represent mechanical torque, Te represent electrical torque of a machine, and omega Sm, as already we have discussed, represent the angular velocity of the rotor in mechanical radians per second. So Te and Tm are the two torques which are acting in opposite direction, and Te represent electrical torque and Tm represent mechanical torque. Mechanical torque, or in other terms, it is called as a shaft torque. Okay, and under steady state condition, we can say that electrical torque is equal to mechanical torque. What's the steady state condition of the stable condition in a power system? In an electrical synchronous machine. Steady state means the system or the machine is rotating at a speed is equal to synchronous speed. For that to happen, your electrical torque should be equal to mechanical torque. Okay, so that means under stable condition, electrical torque is equal to mechanical torque. In this case, machine will be rotating at a speed, constant speed, and that speed is called the synchronous speed. And if there is any difference between two, that is, if the Te and Tm are not equal, or Te minus Tm is not equal to zero, that is called Ta. That is, Ta is equal to Tm minus Te. Under normal operating condition, this Ta is equal to zero, or Tm is equal to Te. Okay, so in any other case, if there is Ta, there is some value for Ta, then that Ta is called accelerating or deaccelerating torque. Okay, when your mechanical power is higher, it would be accelerating torque. When your electrical torque is higher, that torque is called deaccelerating torque. Hope this much is clear. So far we have mentioned that there are two types of torque, electrical and mechanical torque. Under stable operating condition or under steady state operating condition, Tm is equal to Te. Now, let delta M, we know this, right? Delta M is the angular displacement of the rotor with respect to a stationary reference frame. We know what is this reference frame and all. Okay, with reference to a constant reference frame, what is the angle of your rotor? Angular displacement of the rotor, that is represented by theta M. Okay, now delta M is the angular displacement of the rotor with respect to a synchronously rotating reference frame. Because if a frame is there which is rotating at a speed is equal to synchronous speed, okay, with reference to that reference axis, what is the displacement of your rotor? So if there is any displacement of the rotor with respect to this synchronously rotating reference frame, what does that indicate? That indicate what? Your rotor is not rotating at a speed is equal to synchronous speed. If your rotor was rotating at a speed is equal to synchronous speed, what would be the angular displacement with respect to that? It would be is equal to zero, right? See, Now, what is this reference frame? This axis is rotating at a speed equal to synchronous speed. If the rotor is also rotating at a speed is equal to synchronous speed, here there will not be any angular displacement. But if your rotor is rotating at a speed other than synchronous speed, there will be an angular displacement, and that is represented by delta m. Okay. Now, by Newton's second law, you can say that F is equal to ma. Excuse me. Newton's second law, we know that F is equal to ma. Now, instead of F, I can write it as torque. Okay. Now, instead of m, I can write what? Moment of inertia, J. Instead of acceleration, I can write it as what? D square theta by dt square, isn't it? Because theta is the displacement. So, d square theta means the acceleration. Or I can write J into d square theta by dt square is equal to, instead of accelerating torque, I can write it as Tm minus T. Okay. Now, the angular displacement theta m and delta m are related by this expression. Theta m is equal to omega Sm into T plus delta m. What is theta m? Angular displacement with respect to a stationary reference frame. Omega Sm means angular velocity in mechanical radians per second. Delta m again is the angular displacement with respect to a synchronously rotating reference frame. Okay, that is theta m is equal to. Now, what is d theta m by dt? That would be omega Sm by d delta m by dt. Or d square theta m by dt square would be equal to d square delta m by dt square. So, instead of this, I can substitute this, right? Okay. That is one case. Then, what is the mechanical power? Mechanical power, and Pm is a mechanical power, and Pe represent electrical power. We know that P is equal to omega into T. Or, instead of T, I can write as P divided by omega. So, on combining all these, I can write J into D square delta by dt square would be equal to, instead of T, I can write it as P by omega. So, instead of Tm, I can write it as Pm by omega Sm. And instead of Te, we can write it as Pe by omega Sm. Okay. Or carrying omega Sm over this side, it would be J into omega Sm into D square delta by dt square is equal to Pm minus Pe. Now, we know this. What is H? H is equal to stored kinetic energy by base MVA. What was stored kinetic energy, you remember? Half J omega Sm square divided by G. From this, what is J into omega Sm? J into omega Sm is equal to 2GH divided by omega Sm. Okay. Or 2GH by omega Sm into d square delta by dt square, because this was equation, right? J into omega Sm into d square delta by dt square was equal to Pm minus P. Instead of this, J into omega Sm, we are substituting this 2gh by omega Sm. So, it would be 2gh by omega Sm into d square delta m by dt square is equal to Pm minus Pe. Okay. Now, here I can write it as 2gh divided by 2 pi f into d square delta by dt square is equal to Pm minus P. How did it came? It came the instead of delta m, and delta is in electrical, delta m is in mechanical. So, instead of delta m, I can write it as 2 by p delta. That 2 get cancelled, that is 2gh by 2. Instead of omega s m, I can write it as 2 by p omega. And instead of this omega, I can write it as what? 2 pi f. That is how we got this equation. Or in other words, gh by pi f into d square delta by dt square is equal to Pm minus Pe. Or gh by pi f. So, how to convert it into per unit? It can be converted into per unit by dividing it by base value. What is the base value? G. So, this entire equation, if I am dividing it by g, it would become h by pi f into d square delta by dt square is equal to Pm in per unit minus Pe in per unit. This equation is called swing equation, and this is actually governs the dynamics of the synchronous machine. It is a non-highly non-linear second order differential equation. So this equation is very, very, very important. That is, wing equation is h by pi f into d square delta by dt square is equal to pm minus pu. So this governs the delta. Delta is the angle, load angle. Okay, how would be the load angle with reference to the electrical power and the mechanical power generated? I mean, electrical power generated. And h is the inertia constant, f is the frequency, pm is the mechanical power, p is the electrical power. Okay, so swing equation is very important. H by pi f into d square delta by dt square is equal to pm minus pe. And in this case, we started with a different torques, Tm minus Te, where Ta is accelerating torque. Under stable operating condition, Tm is equal to Te. Similarly, I can say that under stable operating condition, Pm is also equal to Pe. What is Pm? Mechanical power. What is Pe? Electrical power. If mechanical power and electrical power are same, then I can say that the machine is rotating at a speed is equal to synchronous speed. Okay, so that was actually swing equation. Now we are moving on to the next section, steady state stability limit. So in order to know that section, we need the basic swing equation and the power angle equation. You remember the power angle equation? P is equal to P max sine delta, and that power angle curve that we have discussed. Keep those two in mind before proceeding to the steady state stability limit. Now these are the steady state stability limit. We can start with the power angle equation. We know that P is equal to P max sine delta, where P max is equal to E1 into E2 by X. Here let E is a sending end voltage, V is a receiving end voltage, X is a what? Transmission line reactance between sending end and the receiving end. Now we are assuming that some ideal condition. Let under ideal condition delta is equal to delta zero. That means ideal condition means your machine is rotating at a speed is equal to synchronous speed. That is ideal condition. So at that came, assume that your load angle was delta zero. So if it was delta zero, corresponding electrical power generated, let that be equal to P zero. And under ideal condition, mechanical power is equal to electrical power. So Pm is equal to Pe0, because Pe0 was electrical power under ideal condition. Now I can write that P, instead of Pe is equal to Pmax sine delta, I can write it as Pe0 is equal to Pmax sine delta 0, which is equal to the mechanical power, because under stable condition, mechanical power and electrical power are same. Now while the machine was operating like this, assume that your load angle has been changed to delta delta. Okay, by an angle delta delta. So what happens when delta changes? When delta changes, what happens? When delta changes, obviously your electrical power generated will not be now PE zero. It will also change. Okay, so let that electrical power, new electrical power PEB is equal to PE zero plus the new change. Okay, so PEB be the electrical power generated is equal to P max sine. Earlier it was delta zero, now it is delta zero plus delta delta. So now in the next step, I am expanding sine A plus B is equal to sine A cos B plus cos A sine B. Now since this change in delta is very small, I can write sine delta is approximately equal to delta and cos delta delta is approximately equal to 1. Okay, so here it would become PE is equal to P max sine delta zero plus P max cos delta 0 into delta delta. Okay, so that means our left hand side was what? P 0 plus delta P. So P 0 plus delta P is equal to P max sine delta 0 plus P max cos whatever it may be. What was this P max sine delta 0? It was nothing but P 0. So from this equation, this P 0 and these P 0 get cancelled, and you'll be getting delta P is equal to P max cos delta 0 into delta delta. Now what was swing equation? H by pi f into d square delta by dt square is equal to Pm minus P. What is h by pi f? It was nothing but n. So m into d square delta by dt square is equal to Pm minus P. Now for a small change in load angle delta delta, I can write it as m into d square by dt square into, instead of delta, I can write it as, what is the new delta now? Delta 0 plus delta delta is equal to mechanical power Pm minus, what is our new electrical power? Pe 0 plus delta P. Now since mechanical power Pm and Pe 0 are same, because we know that Pm is equal to P 0, same, it would become minus delta P. Now what is the left hand side now is equal to m into d square by dt square into delta 0 plus delta delta is equal to minus delta P. Now, but what was delta P? Delta P was equal to P max cos delta 0 into delta delta. So, instead of minus delta P, I can write it as minus P max cos delta 0 into delta delta. Okay. Now, delta 0 is a constant because it is the initial value. So, this on differentiating, it would become m into d square by dt square into delta delta is equal to minus p max cos delta 0 into delta delta. Now, let this m into d square by dt square be x square, and p max cos delta 0, like this was, I am keeping moving over this side, it would become what? M into d square by dt square into delta delta plus P max cos delta 0 into delta delta equal to 0. So this is like an equation, right? In that equation, if instead of the m into d square by dt square, let be represented by x square, and P max cos delta 0, let it be represented by c. So it become m x square plus c into delta delta is equal to 0. Since in this equation, delta delta cannot be equal to 0, because what? It is a small change, so it is not equal to 0. So I can write mx square plus c is equal to 0, or x is equal to root of minus c by m. What is this minus c by m? If it is root of minus something, you can say that x is the roots of the characteristic equation, right? So what will happen? X is equal to root of minus c by m, where x is what? This root of this equation, this characteristic equation root. Now case 1, I am considering C is positive. Okay, let C is equal to positive. What is C? C is P max cos delta 0. Okay, let that P max cos delta 0 is positive, or P max cos delta 0 is greater than 0. Okay, what will happen when C is positive? When C is positive, x is equal to root of minus c by m. What will be the value of x? Would it be real or would it be imaginary? You can say that they will be purely imaginary. What will happen when your roots of the characteristic equation are purely imaginary? Your system is purely oscillatory. So what we can say, it is a complex conjugate and your system will be stable, right? It is marginally stable or stable if it is purely imaginary. So the practical system is stable for provided P max cos delta 0 is greater than 0. So your system will be stable. Now second case is when C is negative. When C is negative, what happens? X is equal to root of minus C by M. So your roots will be positive. When your roots are positive, means it would be in the right hand side of your plane. When the roots are on the equal and are real in magnitude, what happens to its stability? Due to this positive root, what happens when the roots will be here, right? What will happen when these roots are over this side? Your system will be highly unstable. Your system is unstable means in this particular case, our system will lose its synchronism. That means P max cos delta 0 should not be less than 0. It should be greater than 0. By keeping these two considerations, P max cos delta 0 denotes the steady state stability of the system. So it is called synchronizing coefficient or stiffness. Synchronizing coefficient is P max cos delta 0. When your P max cos delta 0 is less than 0, what happens? Your system will be unstable. Unstable means it will lose synchronism. Now let's see what is the limit. Okay, so we got two conditions. If it is greater than 0, your system is stable. If it is less than 0, your system is unstable. Now we will see what is the limit. So when the delta 0 is between 0 and pi by 2, what does this mean? Cos delta 0 is greater than 0. Or Pmax cos delta 0 is greater than 0, or your system is stable. Okay. Now, when delta 0 is equal to pi by 2, what happens? Pmax cos delta 0 equal to 0. Electrical power is equal to Pmax. Now, when your delta 0 is greater than pi by 2, your cos delta 0 is less than 0. Cos delta is negative, or Pmax cos delta is negative. That is, system is unstable. Now, you tell me what should be the limit of delta. When the delta is 0, Pmax cos delta is positive, system is stable. When your delta is in any value between 0 and pi by 2, your Pmax cos delta 0 is positive and your system is stable. So at pi by 2, it will be getting the maximum power. And when your delta is greater than pi by 2, your system becomes highly unstable. Now, what is the steady state stability limit? Now, from this, I can conclude that the steady state stability limit is pi by 2. That means, what does this indicate? For your system to be steady state stable, the load angle or the torque angle should be less than pi by 2. If your delta is greater than pi by 2, Pmax cos delta will be negative and your system will be highly unstable. That means practically our system has to be operated below the steady state stability limit. That means practically your delta should be operated less than pi by 2 for your system to be steady state stable. Now, what was steady state stability? When a small disturbance is applying or increasing given to a system, and if it is increased gradually, whenever a disturbance is given to a system, its load angle delta changes. Okay, if you are gradually increasing the disturbance, the load angle delta also increases. If this load angle delta becomes greater than what? The load angle delta becomes greater than pi by 2, what happens? That was the limit and beyond which your system will move out of synchronism. So this is the steady state limit. So this is how we can prove that the steady state limit of a machine is pi by 2. Okay, so in order to understand the steady state stability or steady state limit, you should have the concept of steady state stability, the swing equation, that is h by pi f into d square delta by dt square is equal to pm minus pa, and the concept of power angle equation, that is pe is equal to p max sine delta. Keeping all these cases under consideration, we can easily derive the steady state stability condition of a particular synchronous machine. And this can be asked like how to prove that your steady state stability limit of a machine is equal to pi by 2. If a question is asked like that, you have to derive this, and you have to derive this two cases when C is positive and C is negative. From this, you can and draw this curve as well, and from this, we can write what is the stability limit. The stability limit is pi by 2, and you mark it like here it was stable and beyond which it would be unstable. So, in this lecture, we have discussed the swing equation. This is a very important short answer as well as an essay question. I think in the previous university question, the swing equation was asked in the short answer section as well as in the essay section. So, that was the case. And the steady state stability limit can be asked in like this. It will not be asked like what is the steady state stability. Instead, it can be asked that prove that the steady state stability limit is pi by 2. Or as a short answer, it can be asked like what is synchronizing coefficient of a synchronous machine. Okay, so Pmax cos delta 0 is called the synchronizing coefficient. Why is it called so? Because Pmax cos delta 0 determines the system stability. Okay. So this was the topics that we have discussed today, and if you have any doubt in this, please feel free to contact me. Thank you.